Today is February 21st, 1997. I am interviewing the survivor Michael Jackson, and my name is Jeannie Miller. We are in Allentown, Pennsylvania, in the United States of America, and the language we're using is English. Today is February 21st, 1997. The survivor we are interviewing is Michael Jackson, and I am Jeannie Miller. We are interviewing in Allentown, Pennsylvania, in the United States of America, and the language we're using is English.
Now we have the red light on.
What is your name?
My name is Michael Jackson. I was born in Torun, formerly Czechoslovakia. Torun was located...
Well, before we go into that, would you just spell your name, please?
My MichaelJacksoN. Michael Jackson. I think I should mention my original name formerly was Michael Jakubovich, JAKUBOVICS.
And you said that your name, your place of birth was Torun. What is your age now?
I was born November 18, 1920, I am 77 years of age, going to be in November.
Tell us about your early life as a child.
I was born in Torun. My parents' name, my mother's father's name was Abraham. My mother's name was Rivka. I was the fourth child that they had. When I was born, my father was almost 50 years old. My mother was a year younger, about 49 or maybe 48. And my very oldest brother, his name was Eliezer. He was born in 1897. Next to him, my brother Moshe was born in 1899. And my other brother, that was the closest to me, was born in 1907. When I was born, after World War I, this area in the Carpathian belonged to the former Czechoslovakia. Torun was located exactly at the border between Poland in Czechoslovakia. That was the last village. On the other side of the mountain was already Poland, and the next village was called Wyszków, which was Poland.
What was your religious life like?
The religious life in these areas was, as I mentioned already to you yesterday, a Hasidic, very observant religious life. In Torun, we had 135 Jewish families. The village consisted roughly of about 3,000 people. 135 families were roughly 800 souls. That included Lopishna, Shchora, and Preslav. This was like three streets or three sides of a mountain that was considered Torun. We had in Torun three synagogues, two mikvahs, and there was a Hebrew school in Torun. And this was a unique school, because in the entire Carpathian region, in small places like Torun, there were no Hebrew schools. The only place that had a Hebrew school was cities like Munkacs and Hust or Sevelush. And also, the schools that they had were organized later. The school, the Hebrew school in Torun, for some reason, was already in 1920 in existence. It was, in general, like I said, the public schools was Ruthenian and Czech, and the most of the population in the small villages, because villages like Torun were dotted all the way to the city of Hust, which was west of Torun, about 87 kilometers. Some had more or less between 2,000 and 3,000 populations. The Jewish population varied, and the next village, which was only 4 kilometers from Torun, was called Bistra, and they only had about 100 Jewish families. But the interesting thing about it was that in Bistra, there was no Zionist movement, and in Torun, there was a Zionist organization, the Chovevei Tzion, and they were the ones that, with the help, I think they did get help from the American Joint Distribution Committee to organize the Hebrew school in Torun. In general, the children went to public school a half a day, and after they went out from public school, they went to cheder. That was the education that they get, and that was the main emphasis that the people had for education. Was not the secular education, but the Jewish education, the Hebrew, and of course that higher education was already the yeshivas, which was, some of them were very, very famous. The most famous one was like the one in Bonhart that produced great Zionist leaders and also poets. The poet Avigdor Hameiri, he changed his name from Firestone, was his name. He changed it to Hebrew. Hameiri was one of the students in this famous yeshiva, Also, a Zionist leader by the name of Dr. Joseph Potter. He was also a student in that yeshiva. And my very oldest brother, Eliezer, also was a student in that yeshiva. And an uncle of mine, my mother's younger brother, his name was Tzvi, mother's name Drimmer. He was also a student in that yeshiva, but he left the yeshiva and acquired a secular education. He changed his name from Drimmer to Darvash, and his first name from Tzvi, which was Herman, to Armin. And he became later a high school teacher. And that's we'll talk about him later. I was hiding out in his place later.
What was your level of education that you were able to reach?
My level of education was to go to, we went to Cheder, of course, and finished the public school, which was eight grades. One year, the Hebrew school was not able to exist because they didn't have enough money. So I went 1 year to a Ukrainian school, Russian, learned Cyril, the Cyril language, and later on went to Czech school. There wasn't enough students because the Czech the Czechs only had the send in administrative people, but the majority of the people were Ukrainians. They called them small Russians, and about a little bit better than 10% were the Jewish people. So when I finished that public school and I became a bar mitzvah, I wanted to go to a high school, but this there was no high school around, and it was around in the city of Munkacs, and this was 1933, at the Depression time. My parents couldn't afford to send me to high school because he had to pay tuition and upkeep. My father had a sister that lived in the city in Nagyszőlős. The Hungarians called it Nagyszőlős. The Jews called it Szőlős, Szőlős. There was a yeshiva organized by the Sapinka Rebbe, which was the yeshiva's name was Yeshiva Yitzchak Beis Yosef. So after my bat mitzvah, I was sent into that yeshiva because in the same city my father had that sister lived there. So I had where to stay. I stayed with my uncle and aunt there. And the yeshiva happened to be just a block away, so it was very convenient for me to be close there, and I stayed there for two semesters. After I finished two semesters, I grew up within 1 year as tall as I am now, and I came back sick from the city, and my parents took me to the doctor. And I was very thin and tall, and he suspected that I might get TB, and he at advised my parents not to send me to the back to the city, stay here in the, which was in the country, like very fresh air. So my parents hired two tutors to continue my yeshiva education in Torrent. One of them happened to be a teacher that was at the same age as my older brother, older than I was, about 25 years older. And the rabbi's son that was a scholar in Talmud. And they continued to teach me every day. I had 3 hours tutoring. But the good fortune was that we had in Torun a library. At the Hebrew school had a library, and in the library, it wasn't common in the small villages to have libraries. In our libraries, we had books that were from classical writers translated into Yiddish. At that time, in the city of Vilna in Lithuania, the Jewish organization by the name of Yiva, that exists now in New York City, part of it, which is the acronym for Yiddische Wissenschaftliche Institute, they actually reorganized the Yiddish language, because the language was chaotic. In each area, everybody wrote, it had no grammar. So they organized the language, and they also translated the most famous works of literary classical writers like Tolstoy, Gorky, Pushkin, Byron. I remember Mapasson, and for instance, reading Anna Karenina in Yiddish, or War and Peace from Tolstoy and others. So this was not, you couldn't find it in every village in the Carpathian. It was unique. I told you that I just got that book that was published in Israel, and it writes about the neighboring village, which was only 4 kilometers, Bistra, and it says there that even though they were only four kilometers from Torun, they had very little influence by the Zionist movement that was in Torun. There were a few that left even from there, but very few. Torun, the Torun youth, emigrated, that's after the war, out of the 800 people that lived there after the war, we had over 100 survivors. And this was a large percentage of survivors. And the reason for it was because the Zionist movement was strong in Torun, in a lot of them, from my own family, cousins. 5 of my own cousins left already in 1930, and that's how they survived. And also, there was a very famous rich family by the name of Moshe Smelansky, and he was a writer and a farmer. In 1929, he knew about the area, the Carpathian, where the people, as I said, they were a unique people. They were it was a poor area. The people, the Jewish people, were working the fields. And he was looking for people that can toil. Actually, when they came, they looked if people had calluses on their hands. And that's how he picked out a few families in that time and took them to what that time was Palestine, already in 1920, 28, and 29.
I wanted, before we go on too far, I wanted to ask you about your bar mitzvah. What was that like?
Bar mitzvah. It wasn't the custom in our area, and I wrote about this here. Like we have a custom to make a big party, a big splash of a bar mitzvah. A bar mitzvah, when I was bar mitzvah, it happened, you usually call up a boy to the Torah for the first time in his life, when he becomes 13 years old, and it's done, it could be done, there are 2 days in the week, on a Monday and on a Thursday, that there is done reading in the morning from the Torah. Normally, on Sunday and on Tuesday and Wednesday, there is not nothing is read in the Torah, so it has to be either a Monday or a Thursday. The parents, the father brought in a bottle of whiskey and some kichel. You know what kichel are? You know, I just saw in today's paper, and when I looked this morning, that Leah Rustin, the famous Yiddish writer that lived in Philadelphia, that he just passed away. He is 88 years of age. He writes how the kichel was upstaged, that for hundreds of years, Jews celebrated their bar mitzvahs and other occasions with a kichel. This was a cookies and a bottle of schnapps. And it's customary that the father makes a brocha, which says, "Thank God that my son reached the age that I'm not responsible for his sins anymore." And that's the whole, that was the whole bar mitzvah. Now, I see a lot of people, when we first came here and we saw what was going on, making bar mitzvahs, one of my cousins that lives in New York, and he wasn't barely making a living, and he had to borrow money to make a bar mitzvah. I thought it was out of place, and it's.
Did your mother come and just your father?
No, just the father. I was called up in the morning. I was called up to the Torah, and that was it. That was.
What was the religious life in the home like?
What do you mean by a religious?
Did you celebrate all the holidays?
Oh, of course, the holidays, especially the holiday of Pesach, started celebrating the preparation was more than a month. You know, Purim is a month before Pesach, and that's exactly when the used to start cleaning out the chometz, the houses. This was preparing. You go into the store and you buy Manischewitz matzahs for Pesach. Now people would get together and bake their own. And this was a very joyful ritual. Usually the youth, young people would help in the baking and the knitting, and it was very strictly supervised. You know.
Where would they bake the matzah?
In the villages, every house had its own oven. Nobody, very few people bought. Went to the store to buy baked bread. They baked their own. They kneaded their own dough, and they made. And of course, for Passover, they would prepare the ovens. Everything had to be according to the strictest. Religious. It was a joyful thing, and it lasted. Started off between Purim and Pesach. Oh, it lasted a month.
We're coming to the end of this tape now, and is there anything you want to say at the end? You want to finish any thought before we get to the next tape?
Well, let me think. Okay. Let me think. I think we better finish this. This tape. Let me think.
Number two of the interview with Michael Jackson. Would you tell us about the baking of matzah for Passover? Continue on that.
First, I have to say that there was, right before Purim, there was a committee organized in the Kehillah that would collect money, which was called for Kimcha de Pescha, which means collect money for flour to bake the matzah for people that are poor and couldn't afford it. They would select a person that would. I don't know exactly. I believe that they would have to travel to the city of Chust to get that flour, and that flour had to be specially guarded, that there wouldn't be any moisture in it, and this was always done by a poor Jew, and for that work he was getting his share of flour, and they would bring that and store it into an area where they had in the in the synagogue, and just before, right after Purim, they would start get together groups, 4 or 5 families, and they would bake the matzahs.
How did you celebrate Shabbat?
Shabbat was a totally how should I say that? It was very, very restful time because it was observed very strictly, and it is in Jewish folklore known as the Neshama Yisrael Shabbat. That you got you're getting a additional soul on Shabbos. Shabbos was very restful and spiritual. The morning there wasn't a one that person that, unless he was very ill, that wouldn't participate in the services. As I said, this was a Hasidic type of community, and the Hasidic community has a special trait that they're celebrating everything in a happy mood. Everything was in a joyful mood. So those were the Shabbats, Friday night, and especially very, very often. Rabbis used to come, famous rabbis used to come visit those small communities, and I'm not talking about rabbis the way we understand them here, rabbis that are paid by communities. I'm talking about rabbis that had followers in the thousands. I mean, famous rabbi. They were not a rabbi from Allentown. They were from where they were. By first of all, most of them had to have published some writings about Torah, and some of them were called by their names, the names of the commentaries that they have written. So, and another thing, the Baal Shem movement, the Hasidic movement, they believed that some of the people, some of these rabbis are capable of performing miracles. And people believed in that. To get a brocha, you know what a brocha is? A blessing from a rabbi, it was worth a lot of money, and people believed in that, and so a lot of them used to come. I speak about this here because since we had a big house and we had enough room, they used to stay most of the time. They used to stay in our house, and they would stay for almost a week, and people from the surrounding communities that heard that this and this rabbi is visiting here, they would come to greet the rabbi and to get a blessing. That was the
did your mother go to the services also?
On the holidays, yes. Yes.
But not on Shabbat?
Not always, no. Mm-hmm. No, I don't think she was. Mm-hmm.
What type of work did your father do?
My father was in the lumber business. We owned a lumber mill, and my father owned over 500 acres of forest and a lot of land, and the business was selling wholesale and also retail building materials. The lumber, the wholesale lumber was shipped by river. Hungary has no lumber whatsoever, and so they were very hungry for lumber, for building materials. And the way my father used to do business with company that was in Budapest, in Hungary, and we were in Czechoslovakia, and we shipped the lumber to them by the river Rika. It went 80 kilometers to the city of Hust, and of course more streams got into this until it fell into the Tiso River. The Tiso River was already a big river. You could ship logs. They would tie together 10 or 8 or 10 logs, and the logs would be like 18, 20 meters, which is meters is 20 meters would be about 60 feet long. This was very, very interesting work. Whole logs, the way they tie them together with special, not ropes, but they made ropes out of young from twigs, but they burned it. It was a whole process how they did that, and once they got into the Tiso River fell into the Danube, and the Danube already across went all the way to Budapest, and that's how that was the. This was a business that. It was seasonal. Winter time, you had to cut the trees in the summer, but you couldn't take it out in the summer from the forests. Winter, when the snow was on the ground, in the Carpathian especially, we had a long winter. So we would hire people with horses, and even people that have oxen and sleighs, and to bring that lumber out, and they would put it alongside. We had ports like my father had that would lay it alongside the river Rika, and then in the summertime we hired laborers to tie these together, and of course they were launched, put into the water, and of course in the summertime, sometimes when there was no rain, you couldn't, the waters were not big enough. In one year, I think in the 30s, they built a dam in collected water so that they can release water whenever they need it in order to be able to ship it the Islam, but this was the main industry.
Did you work in that industry at all?
Well, I was too young. The only thing that I knew about was I used to love to be on the sawmill. Work there. That's where they cut logs and cut them in boards, and then they split and make 2x2s or 2x4s or whatever they worked it up. That was a water driven mill, but it had a turbine, and that's how and it worked 24 hours, day and night, and even winter time, where most of the river would freeze sometimes, but there was enough water where we had the mill. That there was enough water to drive it. I don't remember ever it being stopped in winter.
If your father was making a good living, how was it that you weren't able to go to high school?
My father lost a lot of money in 1929. I was 9 years old. I remember we paid 100-120 krones for a cubic meter of lumber. And 2 years later, in 1931, when the depression came, you couldn't sell it for 40 krones, for a third. And what the trouble was that you had thousands of cubic meters of lumber laying out along by the river, and it's not a microbe, some kind of a thing would get into the trees, and it wasn't a bacteria, it was green, it was like a, like a little worm, green worms, and you know, and it would already, and if it laid for 2 years, summer and winter out there, it deteriorated, and the quality deteriorated, and that was the problem.
When did you feel the first effects of the war?
The first effects of the war we started to feel in 1935. The first two families that escaped from Germany in 1945, the two families were from Frankfurt am Main, and I remember they came to Czechoslovakia. And how they came to Torun, I don't know, but I remember one family stayed with us, and that was the first time. You know, I was about 15 years old. I really started to realize what was going on, that they were talking in the house, that his family was living in Frankfurt, in the city, and they had to leave, or how exactly, I don't remember, but that they were refugees they lost, and that's how it first started to affect me as to realize that something is wrong.
Were there anti-Semitic remarks made to your family or anything that of this nature?
And we didn't. In Czechoslovakia, at that time, we didn't feel anti-Semitism. And for the simple reason, because the Czech government knew that there is 10% of the population that was in the Carpathian was Jewish. You have to remember that the Carpathian area was included in Czechoslovakia under the agreement of the first Völkerbund that was organized, like the United Nations was organized after World War II. The Völkerbund was organized after World War I. And that's when the Austro-Hungarian Empire was fell apart, and the Czechoslovakia was came to existence as an independent state. But the Ruthenia, that Carpathian area, was given to them under a autonomy. They had full autonomy. So they had to have, they knew that maybe they have different aspirations. So they knew that the Jewish people had no aspirations for themselves in that autonomy except to live under a democratic country. So we enjoyed more or less they knew that we were loyal citizens, and they needed us.
What was the involvement of your family and you particularly in the Zionist movement?
Well, the Zionist movement was to, first of all, to learn Hebrew, number one, and number two, it was the movement to return to Zion. It was, and while we are at the subject to return to Zion, I have to tell you that my great-grandfather, after whom I'm named, that means my mother's grandfather, his name was Michael Drimmer. He was the first Jew that emigrated to Palestine in 1903. He was in his early 60s, he was such a Chovev Tzion. And this is more or less, he felt a messianic mission, that he was able to, he left his entire family, his children, whatever he owned, he left with his wife and went to Jerusalem. And at that time, the Ottoman Empire, the Turkey had, Palestine was under the Ottoman Empire control. So the belief and the return, that the Jewish people will return to Zion, was so strong in him, and he was such a such a in our area, they talked a lot about him because he was born in Dolina and on the other side. Well, that was Austria-Hungary. It was one country before World War One, and he used to be the cantor for the high holidays. Of course, he did that as there wasn't a paid position. It was an honor to be the cantor, and he brought over the melodies that were used in Galicia in that area when he came over to live in the Carpathian. In 1903, he got up and he left. My uncle Darvas, where I was with him in 1941, he told me the story that he helped him. He helped get the papers, and at that time, they were going from Romania to the Black Sea into the Dardanelles and the Mediterranean, and it must have taken them, I don't know how long it took that time, to get to Palestine. He came and settled in Jerusalem, and he lived there. He died in 1917. He lived 14 years after he emigrated, and when I was in Israel visiting 5-6 years ago, I managed to find somebody that was taking care, has the books of the cemetery of the Harazitim of the Mount of Olives, and I asked him to look up the name, and he found the name and the date and everything when he died. My older brothers, Eliezer and Moshe, they always used to brag that they were very proud that they got their grandfather, their great-grandfather, send them tefillin. When they got bar mitzvah, well, they were bar mitzvah already. He was already in Israel, in Palestine, Jerusalem, a few years. He sent them tefillin, and they were very proud of that they got tefillin. We also used to talk, I remember, in our house, that for some time they would, for the holiday of Sukkot, that he would send a esrog. You know what an esrog is? Esrog in lulav. That this was very unique at that time, that you had an esrog coming from it. It's not like now that you put it on the plane and they bring it over here. It's here. And in those years.
What was your involvement in the Zionist movement?
Well, I was a Zionist. I believed in it. And I also wanted to leave. And I was about 16. I wanted to go to the... There was a hashara. You know what hashara means? Preparation places where they would teach people trades. The revisionist organization to which I belonged had organized a Marine School to teach Jewish people how to work on ships. And I was 16 years old at that time, and I wanted to leave. But I was the baby of the family. My older two brothers were married, and they had their own children. They lived out in their own houses. And my parents just wouldn't let me go. And this was one of my disappointments. And throughout the wartime, my older brother, also that wasn't married that time yet, Svi, he also wanted to go. And again, my parents were very much against it. And during the wartime, when I all those bitter and terrible nights and days that I had to endure, I always accused myself. I was mad at myself. All this here is, I deserve it, because I shouldn't have listened. I should have left.
We're coming to the end of this tape now.
Okay.
With Michael Jackson, and I want to ask you about the languages that were used in your home and your community.
The languages that were used in Torun, and not only in Torun, the whole Carpathian, in the Jewish homes was Yiddish. The second language was, of course, the Ruthenian. Because the majority of the people, like I said, 90% of the people were Ruthenian. They called themselves at that time small Russians. I don't know how now it is incorporated into the Ukraine. But the language, the small Russian, the way it was spoken in the Carpathian, is a slight bit different than the real Ukraine, because I was in the Ukraine later. But all Slavic languages, if you know one, you can understand the rest of them. Now, there also, of course, the official language was Czech. In the offices, you were able to, in the Carpathian, you were able to use those two languages, your Ruthenian and Czech. And my oldest brothers, both Moshe and Eliezer, since they in my father. Since they were under Austria-Hungary, they knew Hungarian. But I didn't hear the language, and they didn't speak it at home. But they spoke it until 1904, no, more than 14, you know. The war ended in 1914, it broke out. I think In 1 year, in 1917, I think, I remember they were talking in the house that my oldest brother was drafted in the Austria-Hungarian, and my father was drafted in it. So they were, they knew a little bit Hungarian, but I didn't know Hungarian. All we know was mother tongue. My mother tongue is Yiddish, and what we learned in Czech school, the Czech in Ukrainian. And of course, since I went to Hebrew school in Cheda, that you learn the Hebrew. Now you wanted to ask me about the warriors. Now I have to start with 1938. 1938, the Hebrew equivalent is Taf Reish Tzadik Chet. And 5,298. That was the year equivalent to 1938. In Hebrew, Taf Reish Tzadik Ches spells Tirzach. In Tirzach, in Hebrew, translates murder. And that's when the murder started. 1938 was the Kristallnacht in November 38. That was when the first murder started, murdering the Jews. In sometimes in June, July of 1938, the Munich, infamous Munich Pact or dictate, where Hitler dictated to the Allies, Chamberlain in Daladier, I think was the name of the French prime minister, that they agreed to dismantle Czechoslovakia, to give back the Sudeten area to Germany. From that time till March 15, 1939, there was a 6 month window of opportunity maybe to get out. Because when the English and the French dictated for the Czech government to surrender part of the Sudetengebiet, Sudetenland, and part of it to cede part of it to Hungary, we were still under Czech control. From October to March 15. On March 15, 1939, the Germans moved in to Prague, occupied Czechoslovakia completely. The Slovaks declared in their independence. The Ruthenians in our area declared also independence, their own independence, which was very, very scary for us, but it lasted only about 48 hours. And it collapsed when Hungary, according to the Encyclopedia Britannica, it is it was with the acquiescence of Hitler to move into Carpathia, but I don't think that this is quite correct. I think they did it on their own, because Hitler Germany supported the Carpathian independence, and they declared their independence, and they declared Husta's their capital city, but they hadn't have enough power, army. The Hungarians overran them on March 15, and so all of a sudden we became Hungarian citizens. In a way, at that time, that was for us a salvation, because we feared very much about the Ukrainian independence, because we knew that this is supported by Germany. And besides that, we have a bad history with Ukrainian independence that goes back to Bogdan Khmelnytsky in 1648 and 49, and also to the Petlura era of 1917, where tens of villages were massacred in the Ukraine when they wanted to become independent from Russia. So when the Hungarians came in, we were in a way a little bit relieved. At least here is a viable government. But it didn't last long. Hungary became an ally of Germany, and Germany was pressing on them to deal with the Jewish question, with the Jews. So after about 5-6 months after the Hungarians occupied this area, they started new edicts started coming out, and the first one that the first laws that they passed was that Jews are not allowed to take part in the lumber industry, to deal with the lumber industry. And that hit especially us in the Carpathian, and because most of us were sustaining ourselves with that industry. That was the only industry. Of course, the Hungarians grabbed this part because this is a area that has a lot of lumber, which they didn't have in their own native land. So that's when it started in 39, but somehow we coped with it. We coped the Jews were not allowed to be in the lumber business. But we tried to find loopholes in the law. And one of the loopholes was that if you found what we call that time Stroman is literally a front, a person. It was a gent. It had to be a Gentile. that took over the business, became the official owner, and the real owners were getting some part of it, and that went on for another year or so. Since we did business, my father did business when under the Czechs yet with a firm from Budapest, and that one of their representatives, the firm's name was Halas. That was a Jewish firm in Budapest, but they employed a German by the name of Schrammel. And you know, this business was, you bought something that will be delivered in a half a year or three quarters of a year. So the way the work progressed, their representative would tell them that so much work is done, and that's how they would pay. They wouldn't pay upfront. They would pay upfront a certain amount, but not what it costs to cut it and to bring it out. So this guy, Schrammel, my father knew him and had connections with him, so he became, all of a sudden, he became the owner, and he was the Strowman. And we were able to more or less breed. That was in 39. In 40, it started getting worse. And in September the 1st, which was, I think, on a high holiday of the Rosh Hashanah, 1940, in September the 1st, 1940, the Germans attacked Poland. They had made a secret agreement with the Soviet Union, with the other monster, Stalin. That, of course, that was a secret. Nobody knew about it. And all of a sudden, Poland was overrun by Germany, and under the secret agreement between Poland and Russia, the Russians got the part of Ukraine, and the Poles and the Germans got the rest of Poland. So all of a sudden in 1940, we became neighbors to the Soviet Union, because they came all the way to Toronto in 1940. In a way we were happy that at least that part of the Polish Jewry was more or less safe from physical destruction, because that consisted of the cities, large cities like Lwów, Lemberg, Stryj, Kamenets, Podolski. Those were large Jewish communities that fell under the Soviet rule. So the Germans and the Russians divided up Poland, and Toron became the border. So the Hungarians started sending in troops into the city, and Toron by the border was choked full of Hungarian soldiers. They took away the synagogue. They took away the Hebrew school, and the houses. If you had an extra room or two, they would. If you had four rooms, they would take two rooms. They came, while they became the neighbors of the Soviet Union. So they started. That was started building fortifications in 1940, and at that time already, the Hungarian government would organize male Jews into labor camps. Labor camps that were called Munkotábor, that were organized on a military form, like 200 and 220 a company, and the ages would be there, but that would be just males. The ages would be between 20 and 40 or between 20 and 35. And at the beginning, they would even supply those with uniforms, those laborers. The only thing was that the Hungarians had on their uniforms the buttons had the Hungarian crown. So that was strafe, that Jews shouldn't wear the Hungarian crown, so they would have to take those buttons off and put on regular buttons, but they had at least uniforms. That was in 1940. It started getting very, very, very tight. They would call in. It was set in the beginning. They'd call in for 3 months, for 4 months, you know. But at least they left the old, and they left the women still in their home, and that went on till 1941. In 1941, on August the 2nd to the 3rd, which happened to fell on the holiday, the commemoration of the Tisha B'Av fast, which fell on a Saturday, and keeping with Jewish tradition, when a fast day falls on a Saturday, it is postponed a day later, and it was called Tisha B'Av Nidche, postponed. And this was exactly August the 2nd, 1941. So it was postponed to August the 3rd. We didn't have the slightest idea that this will be the last night that we slept in our house. I forgot to mention that the commander of the Hungarian garrison that was the commander in Torun, already they were in there for months. He was a colonel, that was the highest ranking officer there. He took two rooms out of our house, and he lived in our house. And I should mention, he happened to be friendly. We gave him those two rooms. And across the street from our house was the building of the Hebrew school. That's where they had their headquarters. And, you know, in the summertime, the windows were open in our house, and the windows were open at school. And we could hear this commander talking to the officers, the Hungarian officers, that getting prepared because we are going to be attacking the Soviet Union, and pep talks to the soldiers. Of course, I didn't understand a word of Hungarian, but my oldest brother that spoke Hungarian was in the house, and he would explain what we overheard, what they were saying. Anyway, this commander, that colonel, came one day and told my father, and he said, it was in more or less in a friendly, secretive mood, he wants to do us a favor, and he said, it would be advisable if you would move away from here. Move 20, 30, 40 kilometers down, because this is a war zone, here. Because we didn't know what he meant. If he wants to take away the house from us because he needs it, or he is really trying to do us a favor. Anyway, the movement was restricted because of all the military that were there, and my father asked them to give us a written paper that we will move. He had a sister that lived 70 kilometers deeper, close to the city of Hust. We will take some belongings and send it over there. But we had to have a permit. He gave us a permit. And then the other Jews saw what happened, that we are sending some stuff away from the house, and a panic broke out. But nobody... It's for your own good, but no, nobody wants to leave a house that he lives in built and everything for so many years, just to leave it and leave and go. But anyway, we did send some stuff, clothing. We sent out clothing, jewelry that my mother had and my father had, and my older brother Zvi, I forgot to mention, by that time already he got married with a girl from Kalin, but he was in Torun, happened to be that time there, so we sent him, and he went and dropped this off to my father's sister, our aunt. And this happened about 2 or 3 weeks before August the 2nd, the 3rd. When this officer told my father that, my older brother, Eliezer, his wife, was Hungarian. He met her in the city of Debrecen, and her mother was still alive. So she decided, they decided that she better, it's too choky up here, we better go to Debrecen. And they had two children. The oldest one was about 41, he was around 12 or 11. The oldest one, the other one was around 7, 8. And she went with her, the children to her mother in Debrecen. The other brother, the one that I'm talking about, Svi, his wife was in Kalin, and they already had a baby. The baby was only about a year old that time. So she also went away from Torun to her parents. The only one that didn't go away was my brother Moshe, because his wife was from Torun, so where were they going to go?
We're coming to the end of the tape now.
All right, so I'll continue with the next tape.
You were talking about your brother Moshe.
My brother Moshe, his wife, he had two children, a girl that was that time about seven, and a boy, her name was Chani, and the boy's name was Shloimi. He was about four and a half, five years old. He had nowhere to go. He stayed in his house. This happened 2 weeks, I would say, August the 2nd. This must have been in July, the middle of July, that my two brothers' wives and children were away from Torun. But we still stayed in Torun. On the night of the Tisha B'Av night, of the second and third, there was a labor unit, a Jewish labor unit, was assigned, but those were not from Torun. Those were Jewish boys from deep in Hungary. They were assigned to this Hungarian brigade that was there. I remember I went to the synagogue. It's customary on a fast day, especially on a Tisha B'Av fast day, where you fast about, you talk about the destruction of the Beis Hamikdash, of the Holy Temple, that took place. And when we are now in 1941, it took place that time about 1920 years ago, that you say kinas and echa. I was sitting in the synagogue, and somehow I didn't, my mood wasn't too good, and I went out, and across from the synagogue was a house where there was a couple that the father died not too long before, and also the mother, and there were three sisters and one older sister that was married that lived in this house, and two younger sisters and two boys. And in that house they housed a Jewish sazet, a Jewish group. And I heard them play and sing, play on the harmonica. So this was very, for young people to come together, because those were young people, and then the older sister was like the matriarch of the house. And it was always a house that was young people would congregate, and it was always fun to be there. So I went over there, and I see this group. One was playing accordion, another one had a mandolin, and they were playing, those were Jewish boys, and they were playing these Hungarian folk songs. And it kind of struck me as I said, those guys are so assimilated. They didn't know Yiddish. Those boys came from really from deeper inside. They don't even know what kind of day it is today. They are playing there. So I stayed there. I stayed there maybe for a half an hour or so, and then I decided this is not for me, and I went over. I went to my house, and I went and got into my bedroom. My brother Tzvi and I, Tzvi came in later, I don't remember where he was. He came in later, and I remember telling him, did you hear these guys over there? They're singing in there, they're having fun and playing. And today is Tisha B'Av, it's not a day of singing. It must have been around 12 o'clock, and we both went to sleep. But we just fell asleep about an hour and a half later. All of a sudden, I hear beep banging in the floor, in the door, and in the windows. Open up, open up. So my brother jumped out of the bed and he said, boy, and we thought that those are those Jewish boys banging at the door to open up. And just to tell you, this didn't even, am I going to give them what they, it must have been around 1:30, 2 o'clock at night. When we opened up the door, here were gendarmes, Hungarian gendarmes. Those were a group of people, the most brutal group of people that they kept for. They were known, and they gave us the order, and we could smell. We could smell the whiskey from them. They gave them a lot of whiskey to encourage them. And they ordered us, you have a half an hour's time, you get dressed, you get the hell out of here. What, where, when, who said? They had the rifle butts, and they were banging kind of very in a very Michigan voices the way they were. So anyway, this is how it started. We turned the lights on and we started getting dressed, and they said to us that we are taking you to be, you have to get dressed, you can take some clothing along, we're going to take you to a labor camp. But it took my father, my mother. My mother was 60-some years old. My father was 67. My mother was a year or two younger. And already at they started going around in the room, from room to room, started opening up drawers. On my night table, there was I put on my wristwatch on the night table. He grabbed the wristwatch, and I saw him put it in the pocket, and I started to what are you doing? Why are you taking my wristwatch? And I got hit with a thing.
Rifle.
Got hit a rifle. So I stopped. I stopped protesting. I saw what, I never understand why my mother told me. You know, I wanted to put on the everyday clothing that, you know, that I was wearing. She said, put on the newer clothing. It all stuck into my, why did she say that? But I remember, it stuck in my memory. Put on the newer, the better clothing they put on, and then the synagogue was just like across the street here. That's how close it was. And they took us out. Yeah, I have to say, we had a maid, a Russian maid in the house. They took us out and brought us into the synagogue. When we got into the synagogue, I saw already there is a whole bunch of people. And everybody started, what's happening here? You know, everybody was asking. Nobody had the answers. They didn't know. In front already, where the Oran Kodesh is on the front, there was, we saw the local notar from the community. And my father had dealings with him and knew him well. And there were two in civilian clothing that we never saw them before. Those were what the Hungarians called Kemal Harito detectives. They were there and they had a list. They had a list, and gendarmes and police were bringing in more and more families into the synagogue from the entire community. It was such a shock that the brain stopped thinking. We didn't know what to do, what to think. Fortunately for us, they brought in my brother, that was Moshe, his wife, and the two children they brought in. They brought up my uncles and other family. And we knew each other in a small community. You had 135 families. You know every family, even... And this notar, the local notar, this was really a miracle. He said, he looked at the list and he said that Abraham Yakubovich is not on the list because he is 75 years of age. I told you that this was wrongly listed or something, because he wasn't, and it was his authority, under his, he had the authority, and he said to my mother and my father, you go back to your house. And soldiers, ordered soldiers to escort them back, they go back to their house. And it turned out that out of the 135 families, they had 18 people that were listed above 75 years of age, that those people were spared. They were left home. As soon as we saw our parents are out, the anxiety was lessened, at least for us. I mean, my brother Tzvi, I was 21 and he was 32, 33, and we didn't, when they brought in everybody, but we didn't see our brother Eliezer, the oldest brother. We didn't see them and we didn't know what happened. We found out 5 months later that he was alone in his house because his wife and the children were in Debrecen. When they banged at his door, at the front door, there was an exit in the brand, and he somehow had a premonition. This happened on Sunday night. In Friday, I remember, during the day, he was in our house, and he said, "I don't like what's going on." He used to be when the Czechs were still there. He used to be a councilman. He was elected from the Zionist movement as a councilman in the city council. So he was get into the city, and he knew the people. He said, "I knew the people, and I see there is something going on secretly that I wasn't invited, I wasn't told." So when they started banging at his door, he managed to put some clothing on and got out in the back, and he escaped. And he escaped. We didn't know that then. We found out later. It took a few days. He managed to escape and get reunited with his wife in Debrecen. And so we were left. We were left, the three brothers, Moshe, Tzvi, and I. Moshe and his wife and the two children. Tzvi's wife was with her parents. We didn't know what's happening to her. We also just found out 5 months later when we managed to come back. And there was, when I think back, and in this pandemonium, the cries of the children in this synagogue, huge hall, and the great pandemonium, I still think I could have escaped there. I could have run out. And I tried to talk to my brother Tzvi, because we were closer. I said, "I think we can get out of here. It's pandemonium. They can't." He says, "No, we can't do that. We are not gonna leave Moshe with the two children. Like, we can do, help him something." But no, we shouldn't do. So, We waited till dawn in the synagogue, and all of a sudden we saw buses. Buses came in, and they started loading the people up. Where are we going? Where? Nobody had an answer. You're going to work. All the babies, the old, the women, the children. So they put us on the buses, and we made sure that the three of us kept together, you know, that we don't get separated. And early in the morning, I don't know these buses, how many people got in there, 70, 80, to, you know, with children in the bus. And they started us in the direction to the city of Host. When we passed villages that we knew, you know, the next village was Oberbistra, the next village was Maidan, the next one was Soymi, the third one was Volovo. Volovo was the county seat. Volovo was already the larger community. Volovo had maybe 5,000-6,000 population, and there was maybe 1,200 Jewish people lived there, and they had the courthouse there, a little hospital was already there. They started deporting the people from closest to the border first. So we were one of the first, because we were at the last village to the border. So and we saw the people when we passed these. We saw people going to synagogue. You know, it's Tishabov, and they couldn't. And we saw the bewilderment on their faces. What's going on? We see all these people from Torun. We knew most of the people, even in the next village, 3-4 kilometers away. So it took, I think, normally it takes about 3-4 hours. At that time, the roads were not paved like they are now. 80 kilometers, you could probably make it in an hour and a half, but it took a couple hours, 2-3 hours. We got into Hust. And there they brought us into a place where it was a huge lumber yard, but it was fenced off with high fences and all around. So they brought us in there into the open field, and they started unloading us. Still there were gendarmes already there. There were military there. Still, we didn't get an answer. What? Where are we going? What are you doing? The plain answer was, we're gonna go to work with children. Anyway, we got unloaded, and course, during the day, we took along some food that we had with us for that day, and it was a nice sunny day, August the 3rd, and by coincidence, I just looked that up not too long ago, that the expulsion of the Jews in 1492 from Spain, the edict that Isabella ordered was given out in the month of March, and they got 4 months to either convert or get out. The last Jews left on Tisha B'Av, which was August the 7th, that the 2nd, 1492. Columbus sailed to the United States a day later, on after Tisha B'Av, on August the 3rd, 1492. That's just a coincidence that all these tragedies coincided it at the same date. Well, we stayed there during the day, and I took a walk around the perimeters of that huge lumber yard, and I noticed that there were a few of the lumbers, you know, the fence, that were loose, and with a good push you can probably push it out and get out. And I still remember talking to my brother Tzvi and saying, let's try to get out of here. And his answer was the same. We are not going to leave Moshe and the children around. Can't. The fact is, where would we have gone? But we thought that in Hoost there are still some. Anyway, we stayed overnight. We made our beds. Nobody slept. The sky was clear, and the stars were out, and we were out on that field that night. Of course, we didn't sleep, and there were so many babies, children, how the parents try to make comfortable for these children. They were not speaking about facilities for human facilities that was needed for women and children. The brain was just numbed. And we survived that night, and a day later, the next day, they loaded us up on trucks, military trucks, from there, no buses, military trucks, and this was again the great screams and cries, because on the trucks you could only put up so many 40-50 people, and everybody wanted to be together, a family together. They had children, brother-in-laws, you know, that the families were not torn. We were lucky to keep together, the three brothers, the three of us. We got into that, and then we started going and we didn't know where we are going. We didn't know the direction. Up to the city of Hoost, we knew, because this was a difference. It turned out that they were sending us to another side of the Carpathian by the border called Yasena. And I'll never forget, there was a man by the name of Yossel Davidovich. He was a heavyset man, and very, very wise man, and he was one of on that truck. I'll continue with that.
Going to start tape number 5.
Okay.
Michael Jackson.
Okay. I was talking about Yossel Davidovich. Yossel Davidovich, we used to call him Yossel the Grubber because you asked me about nicknames. This is one of them that had a nickname. The reason why was because the Grubber in Yiddish means the heavyset one, because there was another Yossel that will happen to be also with the same name, but he wasn't heavyset. So you had to distinguish between the two. So we called him Yossel the Grubber. I said Yossel Davidovich. Anyway, I remember he turned around to his son that could have been at that time maybe 17, 18 years of age, and his name was Moshe Leib. And he said to him, I told you to put my talus and twill, the talus and twill bottle, to put it in the backpack, whatever they had, and it wasn't there. He says, and you forgot. And he says, how does a Jew travel without a talus and without a twill? This is our last journey. This might be our last journey. And I remember overhearing this here, and it hit me, because I considered him a wise man, and that he sized up the situation. This might be our last journey. And what it turned out, it was his last journey. And his sons, and his wives, and his other children. There is two daughters survived the war. Anyway, we got to the city of Yasina. I don't remember. I don't remember how long it took. It must have taken us 4 or 5 hours, and we got unloaded there and were loaded up in Yasina. There was a train. There was a tunnel through the Carpathian Mountain, and that was the only area where a train could go through, because that was done before World War One yet, that the train. So they put us on a train, and we arrived into, on the other side, which was formerly Poland, into a city the next day in the afternoon. They arrived into a city called Kolomai. The Jews would call it Kolomaya. We stayed in this, in the train, this was August already now, but probably August the 5th, was hot day. They stayed a whole day in the train. They didn't know what to do, it seems. And I remember it was so hot in the train, we begged the soldiers to let us out of the train. I got out with my brother Tzvi, and we and we found a piece from a fence, piece of lumber fence. We put that down and we laid down on there, and that was in column A. We stayed there all night, and again, I think we could have run somewhere, but the family ties were so strong that you didn't want to. You could have maybe, and you didn't know what to do. Anyway, we the next day. The next day in the morning, we found out that there is a Hungarian Jewish labor unit working with the head. This area was already, well, when the Germans attacked it, the Hungarians attacked that area, and it was emptied out. The Russians ran. They didn't put up a resistance. We were so, we couldn't understand it. We thought that the mighty Soviet Union, if Germany will attack them, then he'll break his neck. But it turned out that it was a paper tiger at that time. So we stayed there, and these soldiers, Jewish soldiers from the Munkerstadt, when they saw that here are whole families coming, and they didn't know, they were out there before, they didn't know, some of them found out that their own families were taken away. So you can imagine what they felt like. Anyway, we got unloaded again in there, and we started loading up on military trucks. The military trucks the same thing again happened, that people try to stay and stick together. And I remember distinctly that my uncle, my father's only brother, and his son, daughter, and granddaughter, a little darling girl, 3 years old, and another cousin of my father's family, they tried very hard to stick with us together on the truck. And they were terribly beaten up and put on other trucks. And we were talking to each I was 21 years old, my other brother was 33, and Moshe was still in the early 40s, so we were able to hustle up and get up on those trucks and be together, try to keep together by force. We forced ourselves. And that determined our fate. My father's brother, his family, my father's sister, her family. That's what we saw there. They were put up on other trucks, and we were put up, and that determined our fate, life or death, survive or not. Because from there, they shipped us over, they across the Dniester River. The Dniester is one of one of the major rivers in Europe. You have like the Vistula River and the Danube River, the Dnieper River, and the Volga River. Those are major rivers that flow across Europe. They put us across the Dniester River, huge bridge. See my mind? I couldn't. The bridge was guarded by military Germans and Hungarians on both sides of the river, because this was a major artery in the war. The war was going on already. We crossed that the river, and we came to a place which I don't remember the name. It was it was an empty field, and how many trucks there were, 2, 3, 4, I don't remember exactly, a few hundred of us. The officer, Hungarian officer, that was in command of that group stopped the trucks and told us to get out of the truck and into a field, open field, a few hundred of us, and we were set down there. And then he spoke a short sermon. He said to us, this is your Palestine. He said, this is where you are going to stay. And if anybody will dare to cross, go back, dare to cross the Dniester River, will be shot on the spot. And those were a very short sermon that he had, and then he ordered his police to get onto the trucks, and they left. It was, and I just recall now that this was a Saturday, and I'll tell you later how, why I just remembered it was Saturday. So we left on Sunday morning. We were rounded up Saturday night to Sunday. This is a week later. It was on a Saturday, and it was sometimes in the morning, 10, 11 o'clock in the morning. We are on that open field. Where do we go? Where do we go? What are we doing? So a whole week, we managed some of those. No water, no food given or anything. Managed whatever we had. We stayed there for an hour or two. I don't remember exactly. All of a sudden, Ukrainian people came, young people, and they saw this wonder that there are a few hundred people, men, women, and children, on a field, and they introduced themselves, two guys, they introduced themselves that they are the sons of the Voit. Voit in Ukrainian means the mayor. Those are the mayor's sons, and we should go with them. They will place us in certain places. We should go with them. So we went with them. We didn't know where to go. So we went with them, and the name of the village, I don't remember. I don't remember the name of the village. But those two guys, they started to separate families, and they left in the farmers that were there. They had huge barns in you know, where they even were having outside where they treated their grain in the yards. So we fell in, my brother Tzvi and Moshe with his children and I, and a family that was from Budapest, a mother, a son and a daughter. The son was a violinist that played in the Budapest orchestra, lived there for 30 or some years, but they evidently somehow they didn't have Hungarian citizenship, even though they lived in Hungary. They didn't have Hungarian citizenship, and they were somehow, how they got in there, they were attached to us, and they let us into this Voigt's barn, and in that barn we had already, you know, there was a little straw, and we were totally exhausted from all this. This is a week now, and we started asking. We had some Hungarian money, but no, if we can buy something. But the local people, they were 2 years under the Russian rule, and what they were missing mostly was clothing. So they would sell something if you had. Well, we took along some underwear and some other clothing. So for if you sold some underwear, you were able to get either milk or eggs or bread or something. So how do I know it was Shabbos? That it was already a week. We asked the people in that barn, you know, the mayor's son, if there are Jewish people here in this village. He said, yes, there is one Jewish family, and he is down there where you have by the well. You know, the local community, they had a well. So I picked up with my brother Tzvi, Moshe, and the children. They stayed. In the meantime, my sister-in-law, Monsi, was able to barter for some underwear or whatever she had, and got a little milk for the children and something to eat. And Tzvi and I took off in the direction that he showed, where so we came to a place, we saw the local well where the people bring their water, and we got into a house. We saw, because I looked at the house, I saw that there is a mezuzah, so I knew we were in the right place. And we came in. We found a man slumped over a chair by the table, and he was kind of, it was a hot day, and he was kind of taking a nap, and when we came in, we woke him up, and then I saw that there was a white tablecloth on the table. I realized it was Shabbos. I saw a few crumbs, and millions of flies were on that table. So we introduced ourselves and we talked to him. He said, "Are there more Jews?" And he says, "No, he is alone. His daughter, he was lamenting that his daughter left with a retreating Russian army because she was a communist official during the 2 years that the Russians, from 39 to 41, that the Russians were there. So she was afraid to stay behind, and he was lamenting that he is alone, left all alone. Of course, we saw that this man is of no help to us. He can't do anything for us. I remember just asking him, why is there so many flies here? And he was kind of like talking to himself, saying, the war. And so the two of us walked out of there. Hungry we were already, plenty, because whatever food we had, we didn't want to. We kept the food for the children. And on the fields were, this is an area where it's an agrarian area there was a lot of corn and wheat. Already, it was already cut and put in bundles, but when the war broke out, everything was left, and those were the Russian kolkhozes. So there was no direct ownership on that. So we went out on one of those fields with my brother Tzvi and I, and we started taking some rubbing with our fingers. We rubbed some corns, and we rubbed some of the kernels from wheat, and we sat there for an hour or two. I don't remember exactly. We ate some of these, and then we took up and we went back to this to the place where where my brother Moshe was, and of course we told them that we found that Jew, and we ate already. He said that they bought some bread. So that's why I know that it took. We lost in that whole tension. We lost the time. We lost it completely. It was almost a week time. Not almost, you know, it was Saturday. Are we close? We have 4 minutes. Okay. We stayed in that place 3 or 4 days. Between the meantime, the local people, the local Ukrainians, they were so hungry for clothing that they came. They knew that these are. They came with some had bread, eggs, cheese, and they would want to buy pants, if you had pants or clothing. Money they didn't want. The Hungarian money didn't do them any good. So we bought enough food so that we were able to survive with some bread. And after 4 or 5 days that we were in there, the sons, the order came that we cannot stay there anymore. We have to go. Where? You cannot go back to the Dniester River. You have to go only in one direction. And the direction was to the next city, closer to Kamenets Podolsky, was called Tlust. And we got driven out from these houses, of these actually barns, and all of a sudden we found ourselves again, a whole bunch, maybe a couple hundred of us, found ourselves on the street, and everybody has a different opinion. Where are we going? One group said, let's go to Tlust. Another group said, let's try to get back. We'll try to go back to. And with all this commotion, we got divided up again. One group decided to go east, another decided. We came into a group that decided to go back. And the place to go back, that place was called Istichka. I remember that well. So a few hundred of us started walking towards Istichka. And here we had a big surprise. We came into a field. And, you know, some of the people in our group were so religious that it was in the morning that they wanted to get to light film and to pray. I just looked up the date and I see I made, I want to make a correction. The German attack on Poland, I stated, was 1940, September the 1st. This is the wrong date. The right date was September the 1st, 1939, not 1940.
Now, in the story, you were telling us that some people wanted to pray.
Yes. in all this turmoil, I learned, I saw that time that adversity affected people entirely different ways. In one way, people that were not very religious before, all of a sudden, the adversity and that be brought out of in brought out the they became all of a sudden very religious, and those that were religious before, you know, lived a religious life, it had the opposite effect on them. It and I'll tell you why. This is what reminded me. So people started to stop and to pray on a field, but by the field, the highway was gone. We weren't too far from the highway. All of a sudden, we noticed German military in military trucks were going somewhere. They were going up, and then. All of a sudden, one guy that was a very religious guy, a shochet, from a small community, I knew the community, but I didn't know the man, and he started yelling and screaming. He says, do you want to draw attention to yourself? You had the talus on, you know, that there are Germans. We kind of, even though the Hungarians did all that, but we kind of were scared more of the Germans than we were scared of the. And at that time, I remember that this man said, he said, I laid film, you know, very religious Jews would lay two different kinds of film. Not, well, you know what film is. They would lay one kind of film and daven until the after the Shmona Esra, and then they would start take these film off and put on another set of film. The one is the set of the Rashi film, and these are called by the Tam's film. That's not important right now, but very, very pious and religious Jews would do that. Most of them would not do it. I mean, I used to see that, for instance, my father wouldn't do that. But I used to see we had our rabbi, the shochet, you know, those that were making a living in the congregation as religious leaders, they would observe these things. And he started screaming. He said, I'm sorry all my life that I laid two pairs of twill. Throw the twill away, throw the talus away. And he was starting like blasphemy. And I looked at that, and this is the type of Jew that would say something. It turned out, we found out that he somehow lost his daughter and a child that was, he escaped, and he lost it in a few days. How he got to our group, I don't know. Maybe he came a day later, or I don't know exactly. Anyway, that's why I said that it had. Now this woman and the two daughters. In the song that were living in Budapest, they were completely assimilated, and all of a sudden, they didn't know anything about Judaism. I remember they started asking us. It had an opposite effect on them. So anyway, the conflict was resolved, that most of the people stopped praying, and we started on going in the direction back to the Dniester. With there were small children, and after a few hours walking on the highway in single lanes, they got tired. The good fortune was that it was summer and there was no rain and it wasn't warm outside in August. So we decided we'll take a rest. We laid again in off from the highway into a field. Everybody had his little packle, his whatever he had with him, and we made ourselves comfortable, so to speak. And then it got already dark. We decided we'll continue to our walk next day. We stayed on that field. It was already 8, 9, 10 o'clock at night. We could hear moans and groans, but we were, how many we were in there? I think roughly a couple hundred people were in there. But the local Ukrainian guys, they watched our movement. They saw which way we are going. And we didn't know that. So they devised a plot how to get, we all had packages that we, how to get all this. When we were making nighttime in that group on the field, they surrounded us, our group, from, and they started a barrage of stones throwing at us at the night in that group. They figured everybody will run away. Anyway, all of a sudden, the night, the quietness broke open. Some kids and some people got busted their heads with stones, and a tremendous scream broke out, and pandemonium broke out. And we didn't know where it's coming. And it's a hail of stones. I myself got one in the back too. We jumped up and we started to run to the highway. It was a very dark, pitch dark night. We ran to the highway. In the meantime, we realized we ran, and most of the children are not here. So we started running back, and while we were running back, we met up with them. And then we realized that we left everything there, whatever we had. In those, so we told Moshe and Monty, well, the screams, where is Shloimeh? Shloimeh was missing. Until they found him, we told them to stay here. We are going back. For Tzvi and I will go back. We run back, Unfortunately, we found our packages. We grabbed them and we started running back to the highway. And while we were already, the six of us together, we took, and fortunately the kids were not hit, and they were so quiet. They were so quiet. Up to this day, I can't understand it, how these children, they knew something is wrong and all this. And we started to run back of the same highway from where we came. We ran for a few minutes until we had to stop and to catch our breath, until we noticed from far away, we noticed that there is a barn on the field. So we decided we are going. And here we are only the six of us, the three brothers, my sister-in-law, and the two children. We are going and try to go into this barn. We saw a house there, a barn. So we came in there, the barn was open. I mean, it wasn't locked. We were able to open it up. And we came in, there was straw in the place. We fell down with our poor peklach that we had with us. And from great exhaustion, and I remember we fell asleep. What happened to the rest of the people? We never saw them again. We never know what happened to them. It must have been midday. Next day, it must have been midday. And we heard a wagon clattering, a horse and wagon clattering. Coming closer, coming in, stopped at that barn. He opened the door, and a guy comes in, and he saw us there, and he says, "Avish chatutai duete? What are you doing here?" We started to plead with him and explain to him that we were attacked here. And we had nowhere else to go, and so that we came in here, and we said we would pay him if he would take us to the next little place that is called Istichka, because we found that out from the previous place, from the Mayas sons, that there is a small village called Istichka, and that there are Jews in there. So we figured we wanted to get to more or less to a Jewish community. And so he saw that we had a woolen blanket rolled up that we had with us. He said he would take us there if we give him that blanket and a pair of underpants. So we agreed to that. We'll give him the blanket. We'll give him the underpants. He said, it's only about 5-6 kilometers from here in this Istichka. But he said he wouldn't do that now. He will wait till it gets darker in the evening hours, or in 7, 8 o'clock, you know, summertime. And he let us stay there, and he left. Of course, we were kind of leery. We didn't know if if he is going to keep his promise. But we had no choice. We had no other choice but to wait. And we stay there, and by 7 o'clock or so, he did come. He did come. We gave him the agreed price, the blanket, and a pair of underpants, and he put the Muncie, my sister-in-law, and the two children on the wagon, and we walked alongside. And he brought us to a place called Istichke. At the outskirt of the place, there was a Jewish widow that lived there, and evidently he knew her, and that was the closest for him, and he dumped us off over there. That widow lived with a daughter and son-in-law in that house. And they were very gracious. They took us in. They had a room. And they took us in into their to their house. And we found out that in this place, Istichke, there is Hungarian troops come and go there, and they stay, some of them there, that for Hungarian money, the soldiers, you can buy from them. They would sell cigarettes, they would sell conserves that they would have. In cigarettes, that was the currency during the wartime. For some reason, for cigarettes, you could buy anything. So anyway, we stayed in this place in Istichke. Somewhere between 10 and 12 days. The two women were there to go out. Their son-in-law, his name must have been Lev or Levi. They used to call him in a nickname Jovichka. I don't know. Funny thing, he must have had some whiskey somewhere, and because it was emanating from him all the time, I don't know, in the house. And he was a terribly nervous person. His wife would go out, and she would buy, already that time you could buy carrots, you could buy tomatoes, you could buy corn on the cob, and they would bring. So we went out also to buy. If we could find Hungarian soldiers, we could buy cigarettes, and for cigarettes you could. Anyway, a funny thing happened. This guy was always hungry, and he used to walk around, and we had to have a laugh and all this stories that in his books to him in Yiddish, and he was talking like he talked to his stomach. He would say, which translates in English, he says, stomach, stomach, don't bother me. Do I have it and I don't give it to you? That made us really, really laugh to me. But he was drunk. He was drinking. And another thing, which was, I don't know how and why, a Ukrainian priest would come in every day, even he had an eye on that widow, and he would visit her. But he would come every day into the house, and we were there for a few days, like I said, 10, 12 days. And my sister-in-law, she would talk to him, of course we spoke Ukrainian, all of us. And she would talk to him, and she asked him to write us a letter, to give us a letter to whom it may concern, that to please, we are Hungarian from the Carpathian refugees, and we are trying to go back to our birthplace, that the local people shouldn't hinder us, that they should help us. She was pleading with him, with this priest, to give us a letter, that kind of a letter. And he agreed, he said he would do it, but he noticed that she was wearing a diamond ring. And he, for that thing, he wanted that she should give him that diamond ring. And we talked it over among ourselves, and we decided this isn't worthwhile to invest. I don't know, this was her wedding ring that she got, diamond, that she was wearing it on her hand. That was stupid. That's besides the point, but that's what it was. She was still wearing it. So what happened was that we decided that this is too high a price to pay, that if we would give him 100 Hungarian pengés, this was Hungarian, or if he would write us such a recommendation letter to ask them. And he finally decided to do that, and he gave us a letter. And of course we told him that the sieges, this was their Ukrainian national movement, that we know it in the Carpathian, that it wasn't all the truth, that we are so friendly with them. We were plenty afraid of them, but we had no other way of obtaining this letter from him. We finally obtained that letter from him. One day, and here I come to the one day, the three brothers, Tzvi and I and Moshe, decided to go out to the farmers and try to buy some food. Maybe we can buy either flour or bread or cheese, cottage cheese, milk, something. And we went out, and after a while, we got caught up, stopped by two local militia. They were called the sieges local. They had uniforms. This was the Ukrainian uniforms. And of course, they were with weapons, and they stopped us, and they said, "Where are you going?" So we said, we are here from, they dropped us here from Hungary, and we are going, we are trying to buy some food. So they ordered us, "You go with us. Do we have a choice? We not to go, we went." And those two militia guys, they brought us into a small village, into a Jewish home, where there was a man that owned a flour mill. And this man's name was Isaac Zumer. And that name I will never in my life forget. He was instrumental in saving our lives. And I'll tell you how. They brought us in, those were to this Isaac Zumer, and they told him, "We brought you to 3 Hungarian Jews here," and they said to him, "Isaac, you are responsible for them. We will come tomorrow. We will come tomorrow in for them. And if they are not here tomorrow, you'll be shorter with a hat." "A hat shorter," they told him. And they left. And they left. This guy, Isaac Zumer, he said, "You sit down to the table. The 3 of you, I'll get you something to eat." He owned the only lumber mill, flour mill in the area, and he knew all the local people. He even knew those local militias. And of course, he was not allowed to have any more the mill officially, but he had a Gentile guy that worked for him, so he was another strongman for him. But he had no shortage of food. And for the first time in 2 weeks or 3 weeks since we left, I don't remember, for the first time, the 3 of us had a full, satisfying meat, bread, butter, and are we close now?
Close.
Can I go on?
Michael Jackson, and we were starting with the story of Isaac Zumer.
Right. This man, Isaac Zumer, I call him, I wrote his name as the Malach HaMoshiach. Malach HaMoshiach, the angel that helps. As I said, he said, "You eat, sit down, eat." And we told them that we have, my brother Moshe has a wife and 2 children that are in a stichka in that widow's home. He says he knows where it is. He knows where. He said, "My brothers," he said, "you must disappear tonight yet from here because your life is in danger. I have a man that has a boat. I am going over there, and this man will ferry you over the Dniester River tonight. You must disappear tonight yet. Because if they come tomorrow, they would send you to Kamenets Podolsky, and that's... And we said, how are you? You are responsible. How are you going to do it? He said, you are six souls. I am only one. This man didn't have, I didn't see a woman in this house. He didn't have a beard. He was walking Bikilu Irosh. Bikilu Irosh means without a hat. In other words, he was not religious, but he was a Malach HaMoshiach. He said, you are a plurality. You are a rabbi, and I'm only one. So don't worry about me. Well, I'll cope with this situation. And he left. It took an hour or so. And he came back. And he told us that he has a man for us that will come 12 o'clock at night to the place in Istichka, to that place, and he will take us to the Dniester River and will ferry us over across the Dniester. And he said that when he ferries you over, he told us, when he ferries you over, you have to go a few hundred steps up the hill, and then you make a left turn, and then you hit the highway, and when you are on that highway, you go left until you see three white buildings. The three white buildings is a grain dealer. One building is a grain storage, and the other one, and one is his house. You will see a lantern burning on the table. You knock at the door, and they will let you in. And you will be on the other side of the Dniester River. Now, this was against what we were supposed to do. I mean, the Hungarians said they'll shoot us. Anyway, we managed to get, it was already dark, we managed to get back on foot to that widow. When we came back, we found our sister-in-law in hysterics, crying. She got terribly scared. We left in the morning for an hour or so, and here we were detained a whole day. They thought, it was terrible. And then we told her what happened and what is going to be. This Isaac Sumer told us also, he said, you are going to be over on the other side in this man's house, and I regret very much that I don't remember their names, the grain dealer's name. From there, they will get you to a city called Horodenka. And in that city, there is a Judenrat there, and there are thousands of Jews live in that city, and they are taking care of Hungarian refugees. And he said, this was 4 days before Rosh Hashanah. Rosh Hashanah usually starts September, And don't forget, we left August the 3rd. And the reason why I remember that, I'll skip it now. I remember it because we want to go get ahead a little bit. He said, before Shoshana, I will come to see you on the other side of the Dniester River yet. I just want to mention now, when I came to the United States, first thing I did was I put in an ad in the Talk, Morgan Journal, the daily newspaper that appeared in New York City, and the Forward, asking people if they know the man Isaac Zumer from that area, if he survives. Sadly, I never got any answer of anybody that knows. We are not finished with him. Exactly, we told the people that we stayed, that widow and her daughter and son-in-law, we told them that what happened to us, and we told them that Isaac Zumer hired somebody, indeed, they assured us if Isaac Zumer did, then he rest assured he has reliable people. Exactly around 12 o'clock at night, the man came. And the week before Rosh Hashanah, it is customary for Jews, religious Jews, to say slichos. Did you hear the word slichos? You get up early into the synagogue, say slichos. In this widow's house, they had one room, and there was one bed in the room. So my sister-in-law and the children slept in that bed. And the three of us slept on the floor. And I remember we were laying on the floor, and my brother Moshe, he was the pious, the religious one in our family. And maybe the weight of the responsibility that he had there, his two little children and his wife. I remember, took out a siddur. He didn't go to sleep till 12. He took out a siddur, and he asked my brother Tzvi and I, he said, what day of slichos is there? We knew it's before Rosh Hashanah. What day of slichos is it? And we figured it out somehow that this is the fourth day of Slichos that is said before Rosh Hashanah. That's why I knew it was before Rosh Hashanah, because we didn't say any Slichos. I remember watching him, and I remember seeing tears coming down his eyes. Anyway, exactly 12 o'clock, we said goodbye to the people of, we didn't want to wake them up, we said goodbye, but they did come out and to say goodbye to us, and the man came, and we were afraid that we'll wake the children up, and the children will start crying. Up to this day, I wonder what kind of miracles that the children didn't. They some kind of a mysterious force in them that kept them, that they knew what the situation is. I remember I was carrying the little Schleim in my hand, and Chani was walking already with her mother and my brother Zvika and I. We had to walk a few kilometers, maybe 2 kilometers, and to the river, to where he had anchored his boat. And when we got closer already, the roar was tremendous. This is a wild, a ferocious river. And when we got there, when I took a look at this little boat, I thought, oh my God, here we are, 6 people, the guy, 7, and this whole boat is the size of a big bathtub. If we would have seen that boat, that so-called boat, we would have never gotten into it. There was no way back. We got into that boat, and the guy started navigating that boat, and cutting the stream was so strong that it pulled us down. Anyway, I don't know. Maybe it didn't take more than 10 minutes. Maybe it didn't take more than 10 minutes, but it was an eternity till we finally got across the Yester River, crossed, and the way they told us, exactly that's the way we went. He right away turned around and got his, went back, and it was pitch dark. We couldn't, but once we got on the highway, fortunately we didn't see a soul. We walked, there was only a half a kilometer, he told us, and then on the right side, all of a sudden, the 3 white buildings appeared. I started running to the building as soon as the building came in view. And when I got to the door, this building, and I saw there was a lantern on the table. But I grabbed to the door, but I was still not sure which one it is. But when I started, I had a with my hand to reach out to see if there's a mezuzah on there, and I saw it was there. That was a great relief to know that you found the right place. And then a lady opened up a window. The window she opened up, and she said in a Polish Yiddish, Ungarische? Yes, Ungarische. How many? She asked, how many are you here? So we told them. She opened the door and let us in. Meantime, there were already people sleeping on the floor there, and they gave us a room. We got into the room. There was a bed, and we by that time we were already plenty filthy, and we didn't even want to get into a bed. They offered us some tea, but we didn't. This excitement and this fear for the Dniester to go over against what we were told, we are going to be killed if they find us on this side of Dniester. So anyway, we stay there overnight. I think we stay there 2 days. And the situation was this. This grain dealer's son-in-law was a physician, and he worked in the city of Horodenka. The city of Horodenka was a few miles away, and he had a permission from the Germans, or the German authorities, that he was riding a motorbike back and forth home. That was his home, where his father-in-law was there. And he was the liaison between the Jewish community center, the Judenrat in Horodenka, and they knew how many people managed to cross, to come across the Dniester River. And Horodenka had already a Judenrat, they had a kitchen. But the Jews over there at that time already were ordered to wear white pants with the Mogendovit pants. So this doctor's wife, she gave us white bands, and she ferried us over one by one to the city of Horodenka. The Judenrat evidently told her to take us to a place, to a Jewish home, that the name of the family was Beryl Geffner. It's another family's name that I can never forget. We came in there. There was a huge house, but the poverty was screaming from all corners. There was an old couple, husband and wife, and no children there. But anyway, we got a roof over our head. We got in there. Then we found out that in Horodenka was a hub for Hungarian soldiers, and if you had some Hungarian money, everybody would take it. You could buy some food. So we stayed in this this was the fourth day before Rosh Hashanah, and we got the next day to this Beryl Geffner into Horodenka. And a day or two later, that Mr. Isaac Zummer came across, and evidently he found out exactly where and what place we are. He came to see us. And he brought us bread. But more than that, he brought us a half a pound of tobacco that was cut up. Tobacco was like gold standard. During the wartime, it was a shortage. He said, "You hold on to this, because you are going to go, the closer you are going to go back to the border, the hunger over there is terrible. Keep this here for tobacco. You will be able to buy some food. And then he said, you come with me. So my brother Tzvi and I went. We left my brother Moshe, and this was a day or two before Rosh Hashanah 1941. The Jewish calendar would be Rosh Hashanah Tavshiyam Beis 1942. I mean, Tavshiyam Beis he said, I have some people, farmers here, I'll take you over there. And I went with him, and he came into our house, and he started asking, he knew the children, what is this boy doing, what is this daughter doing? And he said to the owner of that farmer there, he said, I have here these people, here you give them whatever you have in flour. You know, you give them whatever you have, finish flour, and I'll give you double back. Just give them. So they loaded this woman in the house, they loaded us up with 10 pounds of flour or more, and eggs and cheese. And I remember tomatoes and apples and kraut and bread. Whatever baked bread they had, they gave us. So that, and this was a day or two before Rosh Hashanah. So when we came back, this is that Isaac Sumer, he knew them. He knew when they came back, when we came back, we were able to have bread to bake bread for the holiday of Rosh Hashanah. How much time do we have? 6 minutes. All right. So my sister-in-law, she took to bake some challah, bake bread. And we had apples, and we prepared a meal for Rosh Hashanah. Rosh Hashanah, we saw nobody. The man from the house, he said he isn't going into it. There is no shul or anything. There isn't going out. He'll stay in the house, but when I looked out the window of the house, I saw Gary Corner, the third or fourth house down the street in the city, that there were people with white bands walking, a lot of people into this house. So I talked to this man, you know, from the house, Barrel Gaffner. He said they probably have a minion there. They have a minion. We didn't go out. We stayed all in this room, Rosh Hashanah. Then suddenly, Monsi and the children were in bed, and we were also laying down. Kind of what is there to do? We had one master that Moshe would look into it. My brother Tzvi and I wouldn't even look into the mahzer of the Rosh Hashanah. And suddenly I see a truck stops in front of the house. Four soldiers, German soldiers, get off, and an officer. And he comes into this room, and opens up, comes in, and he sees everybody is laying down. And the German officer said, "Was ist das, ein Spital?" He says, "What the hell is this? Is this a hospital? Everybody's laying around?" I don't know, I don't remember who answered him. Somebody answered him. It's today is a Jewish holiday. That's why we are here. Oh, hab sie heute Feiertag? You know, in German, yeah, with the Bavarian, hab sie heute Feiertag? You have holiday today? Then I overheard he talked to the two soldiers. They were eyeing the furniture in the house, but it was very poor furniture. He says, Army Juden, there are poor Jews here, Army Juden. And they walked out of the house. Then I watched through the window, and I saw that they were walked in right across the street to another house. And a little while later, I started seeing they started moving out sofas and chairs, and they were emptying out those furniture that was in Beryl Geffner's house. It didn't suit them. That was an Arme Juden. So that was our greeting for the year Tav Shin Beis. I think I'll stop right now.
And we were talking about the torturous road to Carpathia.
Torturous road back to Carpathia. Now we are in Rosh Hashanah in the city of Horodenka, and we are at the place of Beryl Geffner. Horodenka, the city, had already at that time a Judenrat and a very, very large Jewish community that was supporting the Hungarian refugees. One day after Rosh Hashanah, my brother Tzvi and I went over to the Judenrat, and we told them that we have a letter from a Ukrainian priest to help us out in our journey return back to the Carpathia, and if it is possible, if they could give us some paper to also that we should have some kind of paper to cover that we were returning to Carpathia. And for our greatest surprise, the office in the Judenrat in Horodenka told us that we should come back tomorrow and they will have a permission paper issued by the German command. Up to this day, the next day, my brother Tzvi and I always were the ones, my brother Moshe was with the children, so he had stayed behind, we were the ones that were going out. Up to this day, I am wondering if we came to the Judenrat and here they gave us a document that had the stamp with the swastika on it, signed by a German Oberleutnant in our names, and it says that we are permitted to proceed to the Carpathian border. That's a Carpathian, to Hungarian border. Up to this day, I don't know if this was a false piece of paper, or they obtained it by this German commander and he did it on his own, or he was bribed or something. But anyway, it gave us already, we had a German paper, we had a Ukrainian paper, it gave us a little bit confidence that we are going to try to get back to Hungary. At the same time, we asked them if they, you know, between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur is 10 days. They said that they will be able to provide for us, for money, a guy, because we want to go from Horodlenka to the city of Stanislav, which was a long distance, in a large city, over 100,000 population in Poland. You know, those were considered large cities, not like in America, millions. Anyway, and from there, we wanted to go back to the area which is close to Toron, because we figured if we will be, we know the area in Toron on the other side. So when we went out from the Judenrat there, from the office, we saw soldiers outstanding. The soldiers, Hungarian soldiers, were coming out to sell stuff. Some of the soldiers were being rotated. I told you that Horodlenka was a hub where the Hungarian new soldiers, you know, the military front was hundreds of miles deeper inside Russia at that time yet. So this soldier, they felt lost, no matter how big anti-Semites they were, but they only spoke a Hungarian language that has no similar language in Europe. So in here they were in a Slavic-speaking country, and the only one that were able to talk to them were the refugees, the Hungarian refugees. So they were kind of coming in. Of course, I didn't speak yet too well at that time. I didn't speak Hungarian, but my brother, the older brother, spoke. And he said he wants to sell some conserves, and he has cigarettes, and he has this rations, the bread. So we bought all that. Of course, we paid them more than what it was, you know. And then I asked, my brother asked rather, because he was the talker, I didn't talk so well, if he would drop a card to our parents. We knew that our parents were left home. If he would take it. So he, all of a sudden, he pulled out a card, he had it with him. And he said, here it is, you write out what you want, and I'm going back to, he is being rotated back to Hungary, and I'll mail it. And I grabbed that card, and on the street, before the Judenrat, I wrote a few words to my parents. I wrote that we are in here in the city of Redenka, and we are aiming to come to Dolina. They knew what it meant. Yeah. And I also mentioned that we are all together, Moshe, Tzvi, and I, and I also mentioned somebody else that I met from the same town. And believe it or not, this soldier was a decent guy. He returned the next day, he returned to Hungary, and he mailed that card, and this was the first sign of life that my parents got from us, that we are still alive and we are aiming, trying to come back. They told us later that this was a tremendous relief for them because they heard already what was happening. I should digress here for a minute because I think we left it out. I have to digress here for 1 minute. Because we are here Rosh Hashanah in September, and the greatest atrocity took place in August 27 and 28. 3 weeks. I remember I said before that when we were divided up on those different kind of trucks, some trucks were dumped off here, some trucks, those that were dumped off near the city of Kamenets Podolsky, on the 3 weeks later only, the 27, the 28, that was the first mass massacre, open mass massacre that the Hungarians together with the Germans and the Ukrainians perpetrated around the city of Kamenets-Podolsky, and over that time the 3/4 of my family perished right there. 3 weeks, only 3 weeks difference. So I should mention that there were 24,000 people were killed in those 2 days. Among them were 16,000 Hungarian refugees, 8,000 local Jews were killed. And it was done completely on an open. It wasn't like hidden, gas, open, that the whole, everybody, even in Germany, the Polish Jews, that they said that this was a tryout that the Nazis did. They wanted to see what the world is going to say. But the world kept mum, quiet. And that happened August the 27th and the 28th, 3 weeks after we were deported from Hungary. Now, I just had to mention that. Now we are coming back to before Yom Kippur of 1941-42. I'm talking about the Yiddish calendar, the Hebrew calendar, which is Taf Reish, Shein Aleph and Shein Bais. Anyway, a day or two. No. A day before Yom Kippur, and in here in my memoirs, I have the equivalent day. I don't remember it. You know, it's usually either the end of September or it could be. I have the exact date. We got a driver. And it, because this was a longer trip we were talking that we will go back to the city of Stanislav, and this driver was to take us. We got on, and he was taking us not directly with the main highways. He was taking us with side roads. And he brought us close to the city of in a village. I don't remember the name of the village. He said, this is as far as I'm going to go. We paid him, and he left. And we started walking, and this is a day before Yom Kippur. No. Yeah, that's right. A day before Yom Kippur. So we came to this little village. How did we walked in a line was my brother Tzvi and I walked single lines in motion. The children walked behind us. And we had made up some signs. So we were apart about 100 meters or so that we can see each other in case we see military trucks or gendarmes to get off the highway, to get off. And we came to this little village, and from a distance, I see a woman standing in front of her house in a yard, and she has a white band with a golden dove. So I knew who she was. We came over to her, and she knew who we are. And this was very close to Stanislav, to the city of Stanislav. And so she said, we asked, what's the name of this next city, village, how far it is? She says, it's five, six kilometers. She says, but where are you going to go now? She said, there is a lot of your refugees, Hungarians, are in the synagogue. Tomorrow is Yom Kippur anyway. You are not, you're fasting, you're out. So why don't you go in and stay with the rest of the Hungarian people there. Tomorrow's Yom Kippur. So, in the meantime, my brother Moshe and the kids caught up with us. She invited them inside, and she gave them some milk to drink. And we couldn't decide. Some kind of a mysterious force was pushing us not to stay here. I don't know why. It is destiny. It was destined because you'll hear the rest of the story. You'll see why. There is no rational. We didn't listen to her. We started going to this next community. After walking for about a half an hour or so, we were outside this village going to the next village. We saw from far away, we saw a caravan of military trucks, German military trucks coming in. We motioned to Moshe and the children to get off the highway. We get off the highway into the fields. And here we saw a whole caravan. It was a nice summer day, the sun shining, but the trucks were covered, you know, like with, they had the black covers. They were closed. You couldn't see what was in the truck. And that caravan of German trucks, military trucks, passed, and then we got back onto the road. Got back onto the road, and of course, we, the two of us, walk in the front. We walk for another half an hour. You know, normally a good soldier walks 5 kilometers in an hour in a military step, and it couldn't be from one village to another more than about 5 kilometers. From half an hour later, we came close, I see already the village, the houses. I see somebody stretches out a hand from inside a house and locks the door. And while the hand is out, I notice a white band on the hand. So when I saw this here, I started running to that house. And in all the excitement, I see they had a fence around it. So it wasn't a very high fence. I jumped right over the fence. And I come into this door where I saw, and I started knocking at the door. And I said, "Lost around, lost around. Miss Anayidin lost around." And finally they opened the door, and here the shades, everything, it was dark in this house. The shades were down, and a deadly scare in the house. You could touch the deadly scare, and they pulled us in and closed the door.
What did you say to them?
I said to them, I have a brother here with two children. I have to go. Okay, so they let me go out. And while I was going out, in the meantime, my brother and the children came closer. And then all of a sudden, I realized that there is a gate that you can open here, that they don't have to jump over this here, you know, because we were so excited. We came in, and what turned out to be was that we got into this house, that caravan that we saw before that was covered up in the summertime, with the black covers, that the Germans rounded up all the Jews in that community and took them into Stanislav to the big city, and that was a massacre place, Stanislav.
When you came to the door and knocked, what did you said it in another language. What did you
in
say?
In Yiddish.
What did you say in English? Just translate it.
Yes. Please let in. We are Jews. Please let us in. So they let us in. But the scare was terrible, and they knew. So what turned out was, they told us, I consider this here, those were miracles that happened right in front of my... Now, I'm not finished. That woman wanted us to stay. She said, "Where are you going? You're going over there. There's a lot of Germans there." She saw them going in the morning. "Stay here." What turned out to be was that they emptied out this here place, and then they turned around and took all these that were in that place, in the synagogue, you know, or in where the woman told us to stay, that they rounded all those up. And what's more is that among those Hungarian Jews there was my mother's younger brother with a family of nine young children, altogether nine. And they were looking for us. Had we gone in there, we would have stayed. It's an uncle. It's my mother's younger brother. But one daughter, she was 16 years of age, one managed to escape from there, and she is the only survivor. They got all murdered in Stanislav. So that hand that we saw that was stretched out was to know to get in. The city was empty. Where wouldn't we go in? And I mean, the locals were showing up. So I'm not finished. The locals left this one house because there was a dentist in that family, and in this little village, he was the only dentist. And one of the Ukrainian teachers knew what they are doing there. So he told them to stay inside and we are not going to touch you, your family. Because they needed a dentist. And that dentist, after we stayed there for Yom Kippur, we didn't know what happened in Yom Kippur. But after Yom Kippur, he went out, the dentist went out to work. He told us later what happened in that place where they massacred, they rounded all of them up and massacred them in Stanislav. We always talk about this girl lives in Ranana now, which has a nice family built up in I always, when I'm in Israel, I stay with her. She is to me like a sister. So that miracle, we got through there, and that dentist, we asked him if he can find us also a man with a buggy. And we always told the guy that we have a paper from the German command, you know, that had some, it helped us one time. And he said he will try to find for money. We had Hungarian money when we left. And over there it was closed. The Hungarians close to the border, they took Hungarian money. So a few days after Yom Kippur, we got onto this guy with a horse and buggy, and our destination was Dolina. Another incident happened. The guy, you know, it took 4 or 5 hours by horse and buggy to get to Dolina. We stopped off in a place, and we went in to get something to food, to eat something. In the meantime, a whole local group of gangsters surrounded the wagon where my brother Moshe with the children were. All of a sudden, Moshe come. He was white, run to us, and yelling, screaming, "Where did you go?" And we're being attacked here. But fortunately, that driver, we showed him that paper, the Ukrainian paper, from the priest. And that was the only time that it paid off. And he told, these were all Ukrainian teenagers. They couldn't be more than 15, 16 years old. They wanted to rob us there. So, and he said, "Get the heck out of here." And he got the horse and we got out of there. And he brought us into the city, outskirts of the city of Dolina. And here, Dolina is 50 kilometers from Torun. So we are like 30 miles from the place of our where we are back. But we are here already after Yom Kippur. It could be in October sometimes. So, when we came to Dolina, we knew that our family originated, my great-grandfather from my mother's side was born in that city. Their name was Drimmer. When we came into this house, we asked them, "Do you know a family Drimmer here?" He said, "Yes, I know there is a family Drimmer." So we knew that this must be distant relatives. We didn't stay in contact with them because this was Czechoslovakia and this was Poland, and there was no friendly relations between the two Slavic countries. So anyway, they told us, they are in a certain street where they live, and he had a son, and he said he is going to have his son show us where this family lives. In meantime, he had an extra room, and he gave that room to my brother Moshe with the two children, and they had already a table there and a couple of chairs. So it was a lot better for what we had until now. Now we are here from early in October. The torturers rode back, and we have to yet to cross a border. We are in Dolina, 50 kilometers rather from Toronto.